Today on Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond.
So now, like with my new company, TradeShow Makeover, I do get the opportunity occasionally. I'm out at an event and people ask, what do you do? And so we've boiled it down to, we help companies like yours stop leaving money on the trade show floor.
A third of the people love you, a third don't care about you, and a third hate you. So you concentrate on the third that love you and you go for it.
I think the greatest Achilles heel for leaders is they don't give themselves time to think.
So my journey is one of those, like, there are a lot of detours. There's a lot of going off on the side roads.
Thrive Out listeners, you're in for a treat. We're here with Jamal Mashburn.
Jesse Itzler.
V. John Maxwell.
Jackie the Joke Man Martling.
New York Rangers great Mike Richter.
Lisa Lampanelli.
Mary Carrillo.
Oh, and how nice.
I'm actually going through the practice of being an entrepreneur.
Pick yourself up, brush yourself off, and thrive loud.
Get ready to thrive loud with Lou Diamond.
I love it.
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of Thrive Loud with Lou Diamond, connecting you to the most inspiring and amazing people that are thriving each and every day. I'm your host, Lou Diamond. Today on Thrive Loud, we have a coach, trainer, speaker, and author. As a sales strategist, she delivers results by working with the company's senior executive, using her unique combination of experience in sales, sales management, process implementation, and facilitation. She has provided her expertise to startups and small businesses up to Fortune 100 companies the world over. Getting connected is her passion, and she has created many products to help company leaders and salespeople become experts at making the connections needed to build relationships that can lead to sales. She's been named Saleswoman of the Year, received the Community Spirit Award from her Chamber of Commerce, and the Small Business Award from the United States Chamber of Commerce. Pretty impressive. And we have her here on Thrive Loud today. Thrive Loud listeners, Alice Heiman. Alice, how are you today?
I'm great. How are you doing?
I am doing spectacular. We go way back, I guess, not too far back from our sales cycles. And we both talk about connecting, which I kind of like a little bit, which our listeners know. So Alice, what I want to do is bring everyone up to speed a little bit and talk about your specific business and practice, because you have a great company, a great service, and a unique way of working with your customers. So I'm going to pass the baton to you and let you take the reins. Sound good?
Yeah, thank you. So I love helping companies increase sales. I wake up every morning and can't wait to do that. And so I've been doing it for over 20 years. I work with owner-led, investor-backed companies that are anywhere from startup to about $100 million. And it's just so much fun to help them reach their goals, sometimes help them figure out what their goals are and then help them reach their goals and grow their sales organizations and determine the best strategy to do that. So I have a lot of fun every day, but I've been recently working with companies on how they generate leads through trade shows. So all the years that I've been working with different size companies, even way back to my Miller Heiman days when I worked with all of the Fortune 500 companies, most companies go out and generate leads by attending trade shows or events or holding their own events. And so I've always been involved with that. But this past fall, a friend of mine and I got together and decided that the market really needed some training for salespeople on what to do at trade shows before, during, and after, so that they actually get qualified leads that turn into deals. So I'm still doing all the things that I used to do, but I'm super excited about this new model for helping people get great results from the trade shows and events that they put their time, money, and effort into.
Oh, Alice, I like this. And I've written a couple of blogs about what I think I called it the trade show two-step, just on how everyone is distracted at these shows. And they don't necessarily come in with maybe the best game plan, or it's almost like a kid in a candy store. There's too many distractions around you. And some people lose their focus at these amazing trade show and events, or get lost with so much other information. How do you begin to help people maximize their experience at a trade show?
Well, it starts long before they ever even decide what trade shows they're going to. And I think that's probably the root of the some of the problems that people are currently having at trade shows is that way before they decide what trade shows to go to, they have to look at their larger sales and marketing plan and really understand who their target audience is, which they may have several target audiences, of course, if they have different product lines or different verticals or things like that. But when they choose the shows that they're going to go to, they really have to make sure that their target audience is going to be there and then determine the best way to connect with that target audience. As you and I are always talking about connecting, but it is very distracting once you're at the show. So if you plan ahead and you get the attention of the target audience before you ever get to the show, you're doing many different types of marketing to get their attention, and the show becomes one of them and integral, right, to getting to know them better and getting them to know you better. So as you move them towards, you know, from kind of just knowing that you're there to actually having interest in what you do, and if you're doing that also wrapped around a show, it becomes easier to have great conversations with them pre-show that will get their attention at the show so that they come to you specifically. Hopefully, even you've booked some meetings with them before the show. That's how you can get some of their attention. It's also with the words, the messaging, and the graphics that you use before the show so that you're memorable, right? So we want to give them all that information in a way that they go, oh, those are the people who have been sending me those emails. I recognize them. Or, oh, I have an appointment with that company, right? They can recognize you and you're already memorable before you even start because they're walking through hundreds, sometimes thousands of other exhibitor booths, right? You've got to get their attention.
I like this. I saw a woman recently do something at a very large trade show in Orlando. And I could not get over how brilliant this was. She posted a picture in social media right after she got dressed in the outfit she was wearing. And she said, for those that are meeting me today, this is what I'm wearing. And this is what I look like.
Awesome.
And I thought about it. And I said, this is brilliant. I go, here she is. And now people are looking around. Obviously, they may or may not have seen her on social media, but she obviously the one she had meetings with, she texted directly or emailed directly. And what a great way to do that and to be on brand too. She also had a color pattern for each day of the event, which was even more fun.
Oh, that's super fun.
Isn't that good?
I know, I love that because a lot of times we meet people that we've only ever talked to on social media or that we've never seen before. And I think that is a fantastic way to help them out. I mean, I know I'm always looking on LinkedIn to see someone's picture so I can recognize them at the event or, you know, wherever I've arranged the meeting. And so I think that's just genius.
Alice, here's a good question that everyone wants to know the answer to, and maybe you have an answer. It is hard to get a deal done at a trade show in the sense that your time is very short, you're moving around, you're making connections for sales. So a lot of the interactions you have at the trade show with this great momentum kind of hits a peak at the trade show. Now you leave the conference or the trade show and you want to continue that momentum and make the sale, hit the bottom line. What are some great tips that you can help to carry that momentum over or to actually get deals done at trade shows?
Okay. So again, this has to start like right way before we ever get to the show. I think the first thing is that everyone in the organization needs to set some realistic expectations about what you can do at a trade show. A lot of investors want to give money to the companies that they're working with specifically for this purpose, for lead generation, right? And then trade shows being part of that lead generation. But I think we really have to look at how the buyers buy, right? And make some goals and set some expectations that go along with that. There are some trade shows and conferences out there where they are really buying shows. People show up there to leave with the things that they need. Now, that doesn't mean they'll pay for them at the show necessarily, but they are really choosing while they're at the show because it's the first time that they get to see the competitive vendors and talk to each of them individually. And they get to see new things that maybe they didn't even know about. So people truly do come to a lot of these shows with this mindset. But then there are other shows where they don't have that mindset at all. And in fact, they avoid going into the exhibit area because they don't want to be bombarded and added to lists and then spammed. So we really have to set some realistic expectations, and we have to know these shows really well. We have to know of our target audience. So these are the types of companies that are coming to the show, but what are the titles of the people who will be there? Are they people who will just be looking around? Are they people who can make decisions, right? Now, if we've communicated with them in advance and they have some idea of who we are and they're interested before they even get there, we have a much higher chance of moving that relationship to an actual sales opportunity. If they've never heard of us, right, and they just show up at the show and see us, we can still advance that into an opportunity, but it's going to take longer because they just realize that we even exist. So they're not ready to buy. So we have to set realistic expectations. If we've done a really great job in advance of reaching out to the people that we want to meet, getting them to make appointments with us, stop by the booth, they've got information already about who we are and what we can do for them, then when we're at the show, the conversations can be more high level. We could do a lot of learning and digging in. You can't really do a discovery meeting, and no one should expect that because you're at a booth. Now, if you have some of those private rooms where you can actually sit down and meet with someone and do a discovery meeting, that's great. But if you're at the booth, it's hard. So you've got to have an engaging conversation at the booth that gets them even more intrigued and then makes them want to continue that conversation after the show. So what typically happens is they walk up to the booth, they've never met us before, we try to pitch or demo our product to them. Well, they don't even know who we are. They don't know us, they don't like us, they don't trust us, right? And yet we're pitching and demoing to them. So that just simply doesn't work. Number one, we got to connect with them, right? Which means we have to have a great conversation and, get to know them, let them get to know us. And yes, some of the questions that we ask and some of the topics that we talk about in those conversations can lead us to know whether this person is a prospect or not, right? So if we have that connection and we are memorable, yep, they will want to talk with us again. And if they're not the one who's going to buy or their company doesn't need what we have, if we make that great connection, they will be willing to continue having a relationship with us that might actually lead to a referral. So we just want to focus at these shows on developing strong relationships, making those connections. And that's what will make it easier for us after the show to turn that relationship, if appropriate, into a sales opportunity and continue to move that along.
Alice, my question following up on this, and this can be not only just for trade shows, this could be across the general sales spectrum, because I know you love waking up every day and helping people improve their sales.
I do.
So Alice, is there one problem today that you are seeing more often than not from sales teams or sales leaders that just seems to be persistent across different industries? Because I know you've represented many different types of companies in many different sectors.
Well, you may think I'm crazy when I say this, but I believe that most companies are making sales really hard.
Okay. How so?
Yeah, they are making it harder than it needs to be. So I think, again, it starts with who's our target audience, right? And what is the message that's going to get their attention? So most of the companies I work with do not have solid messaging. They have words that talk about what they do in such a convoluted way that you can't figure out what they do. So you go to their website and it should say boldly right there, this is what we do, right? We sell cans to manufacturers, or, you know, we mow lawns, or we help you increase your sales, right? So, like, tell me what you do easily and instantly so I get it. Oh, increase sales. Now, I don't know how yet, but that can be the next line, right? But give me that opportunity to understand what you do without having to read and look around and figure it out, because people just won't do it. So we know they're finding us on our websites and our social media. So we have to have a startlingly clear message that tells people exactly what we can do for them that gets their attention, then they'll want to read a little bit more. So that's the first place I see them making a mistake. So then if a salesperson is approaching you and you're cold, you know, with a cold email or a cold call or just walking up to someone at a trade show, and you don't have words that will tell somebody what you do very quickly and easily, you're done. People just don't have time. They don't have an attention span for it. So that's the first thing they're doing that is making sales really hard. They're not giving salespeople and marketing people together the messaging. They don't have that clear, concise messaging. Secondly, I think because we want so much volume, we've gotten away from quality to just have quantity. And you make 100 dials a day and you get two people. And out of those two people, only one is interested. That is really discouraging. It's hard, hard work. And I don't want to do that. You know, who wants to do that all day? So I think that's making it hard. And I also think that we don't prepare our salespeople properly. We don't train them enough about the customer and the customer's needs and how the customer buys and how we help the customer help their customer and meet their goals. We spend too much time on products and services and our own company, which is all important stuff, but we're not really teaching the salespeople about the customer. So this is making it really hard too, because now you have a person who's brand new to sales calling a person who has been doing their job for many, many years, and they don't understand anything about their company or about that person, and they're trying to sell to them. It's so hard, and it's kind of dehumanizing in a way, because it's so robotic. It's like, yeah, then you may as well just have a robot calling people. And if you get one, then, you know, maybe have them talk to somebody. It's too hard. The other thing is they don't leverage their connections that they already have. And my good friend Joanne Black talks about this all the time, referral selling. When we say referral selling, we don't mean here's somebody's name and number. We mean a warm introduction, telling someone something about you and connecting you in a way that makes the other person want to talk to you. And we don't leverage those connections. The sales leaders won't even get on LinkedIn. The marketing leaders, or they're on LinkedIn, all of them have a profile, but they're not actually using it to connect with people and build relationships so that they can introduce their own salespeople. And in many, many cases, and over again at companies, when we were stuck on a sale, a deal, and I start asking, well, who knows? Does anybody know anybody at this company? Turns out 3, 4, or 5 people at their own company have better connections than they do in that company, and nobody's leveraged any of them. So all of those things and more are making sales really hard.
It's an interesting take, and I joke about this all the time. This came from a previous guest on the program. I always refer to my good friend Ryan Foland, who always said when someone asks you what you do, it's not what you do that's important. It's the problem you solve. And similar to how you say the communication of the website or the role of the business development person, the clearer the message, the clearer the answer to that question, what problem you solve, how you can help someone, the faster you'll begin to connect with them. Because I think you're right. The making it hard for themselves are these other distractions, no different than the bells and whistles going off at a Vegas trade show, because the casino is not too far by. We want to keep them centered and focused, and you want to keep the eye on them, on how you help them. And a lot of times, because there is so much information and so many different ways to have to communicate to a customer, they are making harder for themselves. So I like making it simple is so important. I'm going to spin this to you. And the question is, in helping you practice what you preach, how do you communicate the services you offer when you're selling your services to other companies in a simple way that's really clear, clean, and to the point?
Love that question. Well, the first thing is that I don't have to do that very often because someone else has done it for me. Okay. So I'm very lucky because I do very good, high quality work. And someone else, usually a CEO, says to another CEO, this is what Alice did for our company, right? Or this is what Alice's team did at our company. And so they just come and say, can you do that for us? Which is
the
wonderful.
Power of referrals.
So, I understand you're 25 or 30 years old and you don't have the kind of network that I have. Gotcha. But you do have a network and you do have people who will speak up and say good things about you. And if it's not you specifically, your company has customers who will speak up and say good things about you. And if you can get those customers to do that for you by asking them, because they're not just going to magically do it. I try to explain to salespeople, listen, I don't sit around all day long thinking about how I'm going to refer your company. I'm sitting around all day long thinking about my company, right? So if you want somebody to think about your company, you have to simply ask them, hey, you know, this is what I need. Can you help me with this? You know, in a polite way. And I've got lots of articles about this on my blog. You know, can you introduce me to this person? And if you've done a great job for them, they're going to say yes. Well, of course I can. I'd be delighted to introduce you. So first of all, I personally don't have that, you know, very much of the time. But when I'm out somewhere talking to people, so now like with my new company, Trade Show Makeover, I do get the opportunity occasionally. I'm out at an event and people ask, what do you do? And so we've boiled it down to, we help companies like yours stop leaving money on the trade show floor. And I think people know what that means almost immediately, but they go, oh, how do you do that? And then I can say, by training your sales team on what to do before, during, and after the show so that they can close more deals. So doesn't everyone want more closed deals? Yes. So I get right to the point. Now, how we do that doesn't matter yet because they've never even heard of this before. So we just want to help them understand really quickly. Stop leaving money on the trade show floor. Train your salespeople on what to do before, during, and after to close more deals.
Alice, I love asking this question of guests, and I'm curious to know where this goes because we're recording this and it's early in the morning on your side of the country. And I recognize you have energy straight the minute your eyes open. So on days that you might not be as sharp or might not be as energetic, when you're having trouble thriving, who or what practice do you seek to help get yourself back on the thriving track?
Okay, so believe it or not, I don't wake up like this. I'm very quiet when I first wake up. And my husband knows not to talk to me, which is great. Because I need a few minutes to wake up. So there's a couple different things that I do, and it depends. I don't do the same thing every single morning. Some days I feel really groggy. And so I literally get out of bed and I have this really comfortable chair in my room and I go straight to that chair and I meditate first. And I do like a morning meditation, kind of a energizing type of meditation. So that helps. Another thing that I do is actually kind of silly, but I'll tell you all that I do it. I'll admit to this. I do one of two things. One is either I have a dance party. So I go downstairs and get my coffee ready. You get the water boiling. I do a pour over every single morning. I grind my beans and I have this whole ritual. And while the water is getting to boiling, I turn on the music and I do a little dance party. And I have a list of songs that I play and I just dance in my kitchen. And yes, my children and my husband have seen me doing this and they think it's hilarious and they just shake their heads and roll their eyes. But it's true, I do a dance party. And then the other thing that I do is I practice sort of a combination. I don't even know what it is, but a friend of mine taught me these moves. They're Qigong, she calls it, which is a kind of movement, you know, Asian movement type of thing. And literally you just shake your whole body like I'm doing now. I'm shaking my hand, shake your head, shake your booty. You just shake your whole body. And then you do kind of a up and down pumping motion with your arms and your whole body. And it just brings all the energy in. And then you do some other arm motions that help you center. And I just think, you know, you have to wake yourself up. Your body's been sleeping and I need help waking up in the morning. And so those are the kinds of things that I do.
I like this. I like this trifecta here. You've got the meditation component, which is the relaxing side. You've got the movement component, which is shaking you all up and, you know, literally shaking up. And then you're taking, to get that extra shake, a little bit of caffeine in the middle of the coffee.
Exactly.
So I like it. It's truly taking the still and the motion and getting yourself into a new gear. See, Alice, you've combined that two together. And what I like about that is it's the balance of the two, is one is calming and the other is literally juxtaposing your entire body.
Right,
the
right.
dance party, though, we're going to have the greatest hits of Alice Heiman yeah. and the dance party in the morning. Alice, let's do that right now. Let's do the plugs here. Give all the places people can find you, all the new links, the new businesses, everything up here. This is your chance to shine. We will put it all in the show notes, but it always sounds better when they hear it from you.
Well, thank you. So you can find me and my team. I work with my sister and a couple other consultants. You can find us at aliceheiman.com. And like I said, we work with companies who are rapidly growing and really want to increase their sales by building their sales organization and really targeting their customer and having a pipeline that flows really well. So we'd love to talk with you about how you can increase your sales. And that's aliceheiman.com. And there's a great blog there with lots of posts that give you how-to stuff to do right away. And then the new company is called Trade Show Makeover at tradeshowmakeover.com. And that's where you can learn how to stop leaving money on the trade show floor. If you're doing any kind of events, even if you're holding your own event and having other exhibitors there, if you're going to big trade shows, conferences, even if you're doing webinars, any kind of event where you're trying to target that audience and really get your message out to them, we are going to help you know what to do before, during, and after so you can close more deals.
Alice, love it. And I got to tell you, it's a really good niche that you've picked here because having been to many trade shows, there's a need because there's some bad practices.
Yes.
Or maybe not really people using the best practices that you can provide them to help them really get to where they need to. And I've seen it. I've seen it more times than I care to, which is why I'm always afraid to walk across the trade show floor. I feel like I'm being solicited.
Right.
Like,
you know, right.
Like you're in a supermarket and someone's trying to give you free samples.
Absolutely. So, you know, I think it's everybody thinks they know how to do a trade show. And every time Diana Guerin, my co-founder and I, provide a program on it, they're like, oh my gosh, I never thought of that. I've been doing this for 30 years. We don't do that. We never thought of doing that. So everybody thinks they know how to do a trade show, but yet they're not really getting the results that they wish they would get. And so there are some things that they can change and make it better for everybody. Make the people want to come into the exhibit hall and visit with you, right?
And it's such a smart ROI because for those who listen, and if you've ever been on the side of not being an attendee at a trade show, if you've ever have a business and hosted at a trade show, these are expensive costs. You know, to be able to allocate the time, the travel, the booth itself in many of these cases. So if you want to maximize something that's so important to your business, this is a great idea. So go you, Alex.
Thanks.
All right, Alex, I am curious on so many fronts. And now from this conversation, I think I've started to decode it because I had a preview to the answer. Can you share with the listeners your all-time favorite movie?
Okay, my all-time favorite movie is Hitch.
Alice Heiman, why?
Well, there are so many components of that movie that I truly love. I just love the way... oh gosh, I forgot his name. That's terrible. Will Smith. Thank you. Will Smith. He's so cool, calm, and collected trying to teach these guys how to get girls, which is just hilarious. But of course, he is totally failing on his own, you know, to thrive with dating. And there's the one character that really wants to get this girl, and he's trying to teach him how to dance. Kevin James.
Oh my God, the dance party.
Oh my gosh, it's the funniest thing of all time because he's doing these moves like the Q-tip where he's pretending he's cleaning his ear and then throw it away. And then he has the pizza where he's tossing the pizza and Will Smith just slaps him and tells him, don't ever do that again. I don't know. It makes me laugh. It makes me cry. it warms my heart. The part where he's trying so hard, when Will Smith's trying so hard to get his own girl, and it's just a disaster, and they go to Ellis Island, and I don't know, I just love that movie.
There's 2 points to what you said, just because I happen to be a big movie fan, and that is a great movie. Actually, I guess 3 points. One is when they were filming it in Tribeca, New York, and we saw them filming all of this. I was living in New York City at the time. So I got a chance to witness them put this movie together, which was kind of cool. That was one point. The second was the scene you just described with the dance scene. Now, Kevin James is one real funny human being. And supposedly to keep Will Smith honest, every time he did one of those dancing in each one of the cuts, it was a different move. It wasn't the same thing. Oh. He just kept making stuff up. All he was really trying to do is get Will Smith to lose it and not hold character. And supposedly there are some phenomenal bloopers in there of Will Smith not being able to control himself.
Oh, so. I don't know how he kept a straight face. You know, the guy's doing the sprinkler and the pizza and the Q-tip. And I'm like, oh my goodness. Yeah.
But the third point that you made, and that is really true, is that it's hard to find the right person or whatever it might be. And Hitch, this whole role of, you know, having someone that can help you go do it. But your power of the reference and the referral, if you remember, there was a key moment when some sleazy guy gave a bad reference about him, and that's what brought him out and ruined his business and, you know, did all of that. And that all came from one bad reference, one bad thing. And it always talks about in sales just how important those relationships are with your customers and, you know, your brand. And the importance of how you make those connections is so important to have that messaging clear, or specifically what you do and deliver for those clients. Because when you don't, in those instances like that, it could backfire against you. So always being true to your brand. And,
I think that's
something you're all about.
Lou,
I would imagine.
Also, not just your company brand, which is super important, but your personal brand, because you won't be at that same company forever. I mean, just doesn't happen anymore, right? People move companies a lot. They change companies a lot. And the customers you meet now, they might be your next employer, or they might become your customers at another company. So it's so true that your reputation today is everything, and that you really have an opportunity to shine because we have social media today. It's so easy to have a great reputation online and in person, of course. It has to be real and authentic, but you can promote your company and really have that brand behind you, as well as build your own personal brand, which is so important. And of course, LinkedIn and Twitter and, you know, Facebook, all of those make it easy for you to do. You find your audience and build your brand online so that you can, again, it's about connecting, right? And making great solid connections that you can take with you for the rest of your life.
Alice Heiman, truly an honor and a pleasure to have you on Thrive Loud today. Thank you so much for coming on.
Oh, thank you for having me. And I just want to remind everyone, if you want to connect with me on LinkedIn, I'd be delighted. Just make sure you let me know that you met me on Thrive Loud, and I will be happy to connect with you and be a resource to you.
Spectacular. And to all our Thrive Loud listeners out there, thank you for joining us. And until next time, keep thriving onward and upward. And remember, be brief, be bright, be gone.
Show me what you mean by you're not worried about it.
Trust me.
Peace up. Peace down. Yeah.
That's what it's all about right there. See how it gets bigger? I'm gonna start the fire, but the feet are going. I start the fire, I make the pizza. Hips are always going.
Up in the club with my homies,
can't get enough tip. From there,
down on the low key.
The Q-tip.
Q-tip.
Throw it away. That's not working. You hit it with this.
Don't ever do that again. Do you hear me?
Just expressing myself.
No. Mm-mm. Not like that, you're not.
You've been listening to Thrive Loud with your host, Lou Diamond. Make sure to subscribe on iTunes, Overcast, or wherever you get your podcasts. And follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Thrive Loud. Or find us on the web at ThriveLoud.com.